Oh, wow. Oh, my God. That's, oh, shit. This is like a real interview. This is one of them five-minute things. All right.
Not one of those five-minute deals. But I thought that, you know, it'd be nice to actually get you in a room alone without Chaz. I mean, I love Chaz, but
yes,
it, sure. It tone changes the tone a little bit.
That woman. No.
But it's a little, it must be a little odd to do all this with, you know, one of your subjects, essentially.
Well, I've done a lot of stuff over the years with my subjects. You know, I mean, it would be really, it would be very tough if depending on the film.
Yeah.
You know, like if it were a film where the subjects are portrayed in a much more complicated way, then maybe doing interviews would be trickier. But you know, I mean, Chaz is amazing in this film and has been an amazing part of making the film happen. So, yeah. You know, we've had a delightful time, really.
It was very emotional.
Very emotional. Very emotional, yeah. But I keep learning. I mean, here's the hard part. I keep learning new things that I wish, you know, we're in the movie. You know what I mean? It's like
everybody's got a story.
Yeah, and I think one of the things that happens in documentaries that I think is a really good thing. You know, a lot of times people say, "What do subjects get from this experience?" Really, I mean, they get some kind of fame, maybe if it's successful or whatever. Mm-hmm. But what meaningfully do they get out of this process? I know what I get, and I think when it works, it's best. It's what they get is they get an opportunity to ruminate more and think more about their lives. And in this case, for Chaz to think more about Roger and what he meant to her. And I think when a film goes well, when that sharing happens in a film and then the film is embraced, it's encouraging for them to share even more, you know?
Well, I saw it last night for the second time.
Mm-hmm.
Completely different experience.
Yeah.
And it's been, I guess it was the night of your Sundance premiere. I wasn't at Sundance, but I was watching on streaming it.
Oh, yeah. It's a big difference to see it with an audience, isn't it?
But it was also the time changed it for me. It was kind of like I had the experience of, we talk to actors all the time who talk about not being able to watch themselves.
Yes.
On TV. And I'm not in the movie, but I, you know, have enough of a relationship with Roger that it was kind of, there were very personal ideas connected to a lot of things in the movie.
Yes.
And 6 months later, it feels a little more like a movie.
Yeah. Was that a good thing?
Yeah, in some ways. I mean, there's less self-reflection, I guess, and that's a good thing. And it's, you can see the movie as a movie more for me.
Right.
So it was an interesting, a very different experience.
Yeah.
I look forward to seeing it again, so I'll have yet another experience. But
that's good. Well, one thing I've been encouraged by, you know, this is purely anecdotal, is a number of people have said to me, including some critics, that, you know, seeing it the second time, and these were critics that really liked it the first time, that they actually liked the film even better on second viewing, or they learned more, they picked up more.
Yeah.
I mean, every filmmaker likes to hear that, because we want our films to have enough going on in them and that they stand up to repeated viewings, you know, that you don't watch it the second time and you're like, geez.
It's amazing how many of the tweets involve crying.
Yes. I'm not on the Twittersphere, but I'm not surprised.
Well, Carter Quinn.
Oh, Cartemquin. Cartemquin.
I never pronounce it correctly. I'll never
remember. Cartemquin totally is.
But yes, everything they retweet seems to be, I cried.
Yeah.
I cried.
Well, I hope, though, you know, and that doesn't surprise me, but one of the things, and I think you, being at the screening last night, certainly saw this, there's a lot of laughter in this movie. I mean, there's a lot of funny stuff. Some of it is cringe funny between Gene and Roger, but it's certainly funny.
Yeah.
And I mean, I didn't want to set out, even with what happened with Roger, which was completely unexpected, that it was going to be the last months of his life. I had no desire to do a film that was going to be a big downer about Roger or his life or his cancer. Mm. I wanted it to be candid and honest about what he was going through, and so did he. But I, you know, his life was this quite an adventure,
yeah.
And it was full of a lot of humor and a lot of craziness, and a man of big appetites in so many ways. And I wanted to at least try to suggest that.
Well, the line coming home from the hospital, one of the times when he says to Chaz, you know, he goes, "It's such a relief," and he goes, "It's such a relief for you."
Yes.
I mean, that's the kind of humor that is really his gallows humor is.
Yes.
And he's it's almost like he has a rhythm to it. He actually has timing.
Oh, yeah. Well, like like the first joke he cracks in the movie, which is at my expense. You know, when I try to make a little lame joke about the insurance and the the chair that he's showing me, and he goes, "I'll make the jokes here." You know, it's like case closed.
So, is there such thing as timing in terms of like how you cut that together?
Well,
I never thought about that in just a second, but like you know, the fact that there's that delay of him writing and the
for comic timing reasons, you probably would have put them right next to each other, right? Skip the typing. But we're early enough in the movie that I want the audience to understand that that voice they're hearing isn't just sort of, he thinks the thoughts and somehow it emanates out into the world. You know, I want you to see that process of, for him to respond through the Alex voice on his computer, he has to type it out. So it's both to kind of let you understand that, but also at a deeper level, let you understand what was involved with communicating with him. But of course, then as the movie progresses, I kind of dispense with all the typing because I just want you to, you know, get the answer.
That's one of the subtle, interesting things about the movie also, that there are the many voices of Roger.
Yeah.
You know, and it's I assume some of it is from him doing a book on tape of his biography. Did he do a book on tape of Life Itself?
No, he couldn't.
No, after that already.
He couldn't speak. See, that's our incredible actor, Stephen Stanton, doing Roger's voice.
So he's imitating Roger.
Yeah, and he's doing it pretty effectively, isn't he? It's so, and I don't hide it from the audience, really. Right. In fact, I've been surprised and actually heartened in a weird sort of way that so many people have not put it together. Because at one point early on in the film, within the first half hour of the film, Roger says, in Stephen Stanton doing his voice, "When I lost my ability to speak," and yet you're hearing Roger, and some viewers watching it go, well, that's when they realize, oh, well, this can't be Roger, it must be someone doing Roger,
right. Which
I'm fine with, because I think you essentially then forget about it, because it's Roger's words.
Yeah.
And Stephen, I thought, did a terrific job of channeling Roger's essence through his readings. And then there are a lot of really smart people like you and many other critics who have missed it, and just because it just kind of flows over you because it's so Roger, you just go with it.
Well, there's also three Roger voices, but there's
the real Roger.
Classic Roger. There was Roger between the time of the first surgery, the first cancer, and losing his voice.
Right.
Which he had a different timbre to his voice.
Right.
So that was kind of, which a little higher tone slightly.
Right.
And then there was also this obsession for a while with trying to create Roger electronically.
Right.
Which I guess never really panned out.
Well, they did it. And he tried it. I didn't put this in the film, but they did it. He tried it. I've heard it.
Yeah.
And Roger decided he didn't want to use it after they went to all that trouble to create it. It sounded like him because they had pulled it from all the archives of him, his talking. But he decided not to use it because he did not feel it was as expressive as the Alex voice, that he had more ability to control the cadence of the Alex voice and make it more expressive. So he ditched using the one that was created.
Because he did premiere it at Ebertfest, I guess, that one year.
Yeah, and I've heard it. I even, at one point when I was doing something, that we had the folks that created it do some passages for us.
Mm-hmm.
And I could see why Roger didn't want to use it. I mean, you know, it was great in a way, but not, it just never quite felt, it felt too much like gluing together words that were spoken in other contexts, and the Alex voice, for whatever reason, for all of its sort of monotone or straightforward nature of it,
it
never feels weird in that way. Like the word, the pronunciation is completely wrong for what's being said.
Yeah, I guess the people who create those voices know what they're doing.
Yes,
you know, like Siri and everything else.
Yeah, exactly.
Put together well. So, you've been doing this for a little while.
Just a little while.
I completely forgot that you had a life as a fiction director.
Well, biopic, and I don't know if it adds up to a life, but I dabbled in
movies and a couple TV things.
Yeah. One feature and a couple of TV movies.
Did you not like it, or did you?
No, I did like it, but I didn't like it as much as documentary. But there was also some mitigating circumstances there that all I was really able to do in that world, which was more than some people get to, was sports biopics, and that was because of Hoop Dreams. So because of that film, when I entered that world, they were like, everything that anybody was willing to give me a shot at was a sports biopic. Mm-hmm. And I think biopics in narrative film, scripted, is one of the hardest genres to master, I think. I mean, I see a lot of biopics that I think are not very good, mm-hmm. and even by talented filmmakers. So I think it's particularly hard. And then just to be pigeonholed in the way I was with it had to be sports in it, you know, everything about it was, you know, it was great, but it was limiting. And so, and I missed doing documentaries. I mean, during that span of, you know, 4 or 5 years there, 5 years when I was doing those three films, I was also working on Stevie. And I would get my time to go work on Stevie and then go back to those films. And it just really dawned on me that like, I really miss the intimacy of storytelling of a film in the doc world, you know, in something that is closer to me and, you know, that film. I miss that, and I want to get back to that, and so I did.
If there'd only been one Prefontaine film, maybe it would have been a different story.
Might have helped, but, you know, nobody went to see either of those
films.
That's true. You know, they spent four times as much money as we did. They had four or five times the budget we did, and I don't think they did any more business at the box office than we did. So, you know, but like I said, I would like to work in scripted again now. And I'm hoping, and, you know, I've never completely given up on doing it, but I want to do it and not have it be so circumscribed as to what I can tackle. And that may mean trying to do it in a different way that allows me that kind of control. See, what I love about the working in documentary, beyond just its essential nature of that work, is that I feel like in documentary, I have way more control over my life and what I can do. Mm. Like if I have an idea for a film, I can figure out a way to go get it made. It's not always easy to raise the money. There's all kinds of obstacles and hurdles, but I feel like I can do that in documentary. You know, how many directors in narrative film have that ability to do that? You're talking about the cream of the crop directors who have that ability to kind of say, I want to do a film on this and then go make it.
Or the ones making them for nothing in their backyard.
Or the ones making them for nothing.
Yeah.
And I'm making a living doing documentaries, and that in and of itself is pretty extraordinary.
Yeah. And now you've won an Oscar for Prefontaine in a way.
Wait.
Because I feel like Jared Leto, you know.
Oh.
He was still Jordan Catalano before you at least gave him a chance to actually act.
That's true. I think I think Prefontaine was his first movie role, or certainly first leading movie role, for sure. And I was so glad when Jared won the Oscar. I was happy for him personally, and I was happy because I can now say I did not ruin his career.
That's something devoutly to be wished.
Yeah.
So, I mean, speaking of putting yourself in a hole or in a box, I mean, if you look at the list of documentaries, a lot of sports, a lot of, now it's like there's kind of an old age or illness theme kind of floating in there as a repeated idea.
Well, I've kind of covered the waterfront on topics in a lot of ways. I mean, I've done gritty inner city stories, Hoop Dreams and the Interrupters, or that. Stevie is
very, a crossover movie.
Is a very different movie. I mean, it's about an underclass and about people on the fringes, but very different story than those two films. Real Paradise was about the movies and the Pearsons.
Yeah. How did you get into that?
You know, at the death house doors about the death penalty.
That one kind of pops out in the middle. I mean, The Interrupters, which is one of the great movies of all time, but is, you know, it does seem like there, because you're doing another one now about somebody with, who's got an Alzheimer's.
I did a short.
That
was just a short that I did. It's only 9 minutes long. See, I can work short, Dave.
I'm not trying to put you in a box, but I'm just curious. I mean, is there?
No, I think that but for me, the thing that's been wonderful about documentary is that I'm not in a box. I've done some sports stuff.
Because the Iverson thing also great for 30 for 30.
Thank you, but to me, that's not even about sports. That's about race. So it's like, I feel like I've been able to do. You're right. I'm probably a little overrepresented in sports. But I've done, I don't know, how many docs have I done now? 10, maybe? Something like that. So I've been able to kind of do a variety of things and a variety of forms even. I think most people tend to think of me and they think of Hoop Dreams and maybe The Interrupters. they don't think of some of the films I've done that don't really conform to that kind of verite-driven model. Mm-hmm. And certainly this film, the Ebert documentary, doesn't. It has verite moments in it, but it's not largely a verite film. It's a biography.
Yeah.
And it's about somebody famous, which typically I've not done films about famous people.
Well, a lot of the footage in this film feels almost like found footage.
Yeah.
Even though you were there shooting it in the tent, it has that kind of slight disconnection, you know, which is, I think, important. I think it's one of the things that keeps it from being a hagiography in any way.
Yes.
It's like, you know, it's a step removed.
Yeah, I did not. One thing I was bound and determined not to do was hagiography. And I was encouraged by Roger's memoir because it's not hagiography, you know? Yeah. I mean, and that's hard to pull off in a memoir. But I think I had the added advantage of I could, for me, in terms of that issue, is that I could, I can use his words, and his writing is all over this film.
Mm.
You know, not only his film reviews, but his memoir are all over this film. But I also had the ability to interview people about him. And I feel like they were, you know, remarkably candid. You know,
people, and they were his real friend. I mean, mostly
people who
they
really
were people
knew
who were
him.
His real friends.
Yes,
because like there's a whole assortment of people who are not in the film, some of whom, you know, different places in his life. But it's like, kind of got to the guys he, you know, would show up at things. You go, why is this guy here? I've seen this guy four times. And
yes.
Like, oh, it's because he grew up with this guy, or he used to. This was the guy he's hung really friends with.
Yeah, I don't think Roger made a ton of deep friendships, but the ones he made, he kept forever.
Yeah.
You know, he met Bill Nack in college. He met John McHugh when he first got to Chicago, right out of college, and with both those guys, they were friends until he died.
It was almost like the pre-show friends and the post-show friends.
Yeah.
And a different universe. And, you know, I came into his life 15, 16 years ago, and it was, you know, at the height of his popularity, and that you know, our generation is not really represented in the film, but I think in some ways we were never as close to him.
Right.
I don't know that any of us were ever as close to him. I certainly wasn't, as those guys.
Right.
Who were, you know, there from the beginning.
Well,
you could always tell in Champaign-Urbana that there was like a different family.
Yes.
You know, his old family was there too.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
It was interesting. So sports is not something that you were driven to do documentaries about. In some ways you see the sports films as you say, urban films more than their urban stories.
Well, look, Hoop Dreams was definitely the desire to do that film grew out of two obsessions. One was basketball, because in my youth that was my life, and in my own, you know, white boy way, I had the dream, I think, about as much as you can. And it didn't work out, of course, but I had it.
The Larry Bird dream.
Yeah, yeah.
Though he's probably a contemporary. He's, what, 10 years older than you?
Yeah, okay. He's a little older than me, yes. Not that, yeah, I don't know how much older. Let's not even go there. But
me either. I don't want to go there.
Yeah, we don't need to go there. But so that certainly was fundamental to me wanting to make that film. And part of what was fundamental about that was that I had black teammates over the years. And I was fascinated by what this dream meant to them, because I knew there was way more at stake for them with regards to the basketball dream than there was for me, as much as I had it. And then the other obsession that I had that led to Hoop Dreams was with race, was with the role of race in American society, because I had some experiences growing up that kind of really turned my head about that and made me think about that. And so that's where Hoop Dreams came from. But I think, you know, race as an obsession of mine has been strung through my work. You know, it was certainly very much a part of The Interrupters. I made a whole film very explicitly about race when I did the Iverson film, No Crossover. The series The New Americans that we did at Kurtempquin, which was, you know, my brainchild, was very much about race as applied to immigrants. Mm-hmm. And then even in the Ebert film, one of the my favorite parts of the movie really is where Chaz sort of talks about how here she was, this, you know, black woman from Chicago who never thought she'd marry a white man, and that yet they came together and had, you know, this extraordinary marriage across a racial divide. It's of all the things that I've captured in the films over the years that detail race, this was the most sort of encouraging and ennobling thing I think I've captured, a statement about what's possible.
Mm. So, kind of lost my own track of thought.
Didn't think I was going there, did you?
I didn't know that you were going there. But it was always amazing to see Roger with the grandchildren, and then the great-grandchildren. Was like,
and to see Raven, his granddaughter, and he did not want her, I've only learned recently, referred to as his step-granddaughter. Mm. Once he married Chaz, she was his granddaughter, which says something in and of itself. But to see her talk about how much her grandfather, Roger, meant to her, and the talks they had and what she learned from him and the memories she treasured, I found that incredibly moving. And because there was no blood relation there.
So were you an Indiana kid or a Illinois kid?
I grew up in Virginia.
Ah.
Okay. But I moved to Illinois in the late 70s to go to grad school in Southern Illinois, and then made my way to Chicago. So I've been in Illinois for a long time.
But race in Virginia is kind of an issue as well.
Yes, where I grew up, Hampton, Virginia. I mean, I get into this some in the Iverson film. It was a town that was, about almost 50-50 black white. Integration came into being in my hometown when I made the transition from elementary school to junior high. And in my high school, one of the defining moments of my high school life as regards to this issue was when I was on the basketball team, we'd have these pep rallies in the gym that everyone was required to attend. And the black students would come into the gym and sit on this side of the bleachers. The white students would come in the gym, sit on this side of the bleachers. And when they would introduce a black player on the team, the black side would cheer. This is a pep rally.
God.
And when they'd introduce a white player, the white side would cheer. And it wasn't this, there wasn't this tension and animosity. It was almost like just a competition, like who can cheer the loudest. Well, and I'm here to tell you that on the basketball team, the white side didn't get to cheer very often. But I just remember being struck by that. And my dad had a business in the black part of town. Mm-hmm. He had a black employee that was his longest running employee that I used to he had a carpeting and floor tile business. And this guy was an installer that I used to be his helper in the summers, several summers. So, I kind of had these experiences of race, both as a basketball player and then working for my dad, that kind of went beyond what I think most white kids in my hometown would have had growing up. And it really heightened my attention to race and class.
And Chicago, it could not be a more interesting place to be in that regard.
When I got to Chicago, the thing that struck me about Chicago was just how racially tense it was. In the South, in Virginia, those tensions are there, but they're undercurrents. And they're an undercurrent underneath this sort of veneer of what they called Southern hospitality. If you got in an elevator in Hampton with a black person and you're a white person and you didn't know them, you would chat amicably on the way up in the elevator about the weather, about this or that. It would be this amicable, thing. In Chicago, you get in an elevator with a black person, if you're a white person and neither of you know each other, you don't say a word to each other. You don't even say a word. I mean, maybe that started to change some, but I also got to Chicago at the height of what was called the Council Wars, when Mayor Harold Washington was battling the ethnic white controlled aldermen. I mean, it was a openly racially divisive time. And I just remember moving there and going, whoa, this place. I mean,
yeah.
Well, and Chicago remains one of the most racially segregated cities in America.
Yeah. I always think LA is the most segregated city I've ever been in. I've lived in Chicago and New York.
Yeah, but Chicago's right up there.
Well, Chicago is, the interesting thing about Chicago is there are other groups.
Yeah.
So, but none of them live in the South Side as a rule, but it's like, it's a fascinating thing because there's such strong presence of ethnicity in the city aside from the black and white issue.
Yes.
And yet the black and white thing is also still, and it's really is like a border. I mean, it's literally, it's, you know, at Water Tower, at the McCormick Place, it's like, that's the line.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
It's like shocking how distinctive it is.
Yeah, sometimes it's literally, like they say, Chicago City neighborhoods, it's sometimes it's like you go under a viaduct, this neighborhood's black, that one's Hispanic, boom.
Yeah.
Just complete change. Mm.
So what was the hardest thing about actually getting this thing, making this thing functionally? You started late in Roger's life, at
right.
the last, fairly last minute.
Although we didn't know that.
Though you didn't know that
started.
At the time. But then you had a, there's a lot to go through. I mean, there's a lot, there's a depth of knowledge in terms of the story, not just following up with the friends and talking about the good old days of the bar or
yes.
whatever, but, you know, you have to go through a lot of reviews before you pick the seven that are in the movie, and you have to, you know,
yes.
go through a lot of his book before you pick the parts that are relevant.
Right. Well, the book was essential. And I think, I mean, when we said that this film is based on the memoir, it really is. I mean, now there are, we divert away from the memoir in a number of places, but it is truly based on the memoir, and the memoir was an incredible, I don't know if I could have made the film without that memoir as a guide and inspiration, seriously. But you're right, beyond the memoir, which is 460 odd pages, there is this incredibly well-documented life of being on television and the writings in print. I mean, all the reviews and I mean, it's too much. I couldn't have possibly gone through really, you know, anywhere near a decent percentage of all of it to make decisions. I had to kind of, on some level, dive in and kind of do it by the seat of my pants to some degree and use the memoir as a real template and a guide. And there's so many aspects to Roger's life that aren't in the movie. And, you know, and some of them I wish I'd found a way maybe, but you can't. You cannot put it all in. But the memoir made a huge difference.
Did you have to fair use the Siskel and Ebert stuff, or was that?
We fair used most of it. The only time we didn't was where we could get decent quality copy. Most of this movie is fair used, not all of it, because it's legally and journalistically sound
right.
and necessary to do that. And so,
I know there was always a wrestling match over older footage. For Roger, even they weren't like really so quickly. They weren't so quick to give Roger old footage, even when he was doing
right.
the TV show and
right.
stuff like that. There was
right.
always a kind of a battle over that stuff.
Yeah, but we were able to get it, and so that's what I did. I mean, you know, this was a daunting task, but I did not want to spend 3 years making this movie, especially once Roger died. I felt. I did not want to rush it out. I'm very proud of the movie, but I also did not want to take years to get this film out because I felt like it was important to his legacy to have this film be completed sooner than that and be out in the world.
Well, people feel like people are ready to, you know, it's been a year.
Right.
And people are kind of ready to chew on it a little bit now.
Yeah. Yeah. But I'm proud of the movie. I mean, yeah, I could have spent longer on it, but I feel like we captured the essence of his life story and the essence of who the man was, which was this guy who had boundless curiosity, boundless love for and appetites for all things. And boundless confidence.
And is there any movie you made that you couldn't have spent more time on?
Any movie I made that I
could not have spent more
time
on? You
mean like
you're not like I could have taken another 6 months to keep on playing with that, or
that I would have liked to?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. I mean, I, you know, someone once famously, I think it was Leo Tolstoy. I should really look this quote up because so I don't have to. But. I think it was Leo Tolstoy who said of novels that they're never finished, they're abandoned. And then that's gotten morphed to every other art form. And so I first heard it as films are never finished, they're abandoned. And I think that's true. I think that, you know, and that's certainly been true of the films I've made over the year. I always want more time. And then, of course, once they're done, I immediately start thinking of the things that I should have done better and should have included, or, you know, that it could be better.
But there's something magical about that thing that's locked in the, you know, in the ether.
Yeah.
It's just, it can't be moved anymore, and somehow that,
yeah,
it becomes what it needs to become, and it,
yeah,
good.
Yeah, and it doesn't, yeah, I mean, you know, it, the my favorite films of all time, I don't know that I look at any one of them and say it's perfect. I mean, part of what makes it alive is that it's amazing and incredible, but it's this thing that has parts that you know, maybe don't quite work the way they were intended. You know, if it's too perfect, it's almost like it's not alive, you know?
Yeah.